Now, the Baltimore Orioles Hot Stove Show with Geoff Arnold. This is your home for Birds Baseball. WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL Radio app.
And we welcome you to the MASN Studios, which is where we're doing the first edition of the Orioles Hot Stove Show from this year. Geoff Arnold with you. I am joined by Big Al Hildebile, who is at the controls tonight. And then Ryan Chell is back in our studios. The Orioles Hot Stove Show, it is something that is kicking off tonight, and we're going to be taking this all the way through spring training. So we'll do our last couple of shows while we're down in Sarasota. But there's obviously a lot of excitement in the air about what the Orioles are going to do coming into this off-season. The free agency period has gotten underway. That kicked off at 5 o'clock today. There's some awards that are going to be handed out next week. The Orioles, remember, have Brandon Hyde, who's up for the American League Manager of the Year. They have Adley Rutschman, who is a finalist for the American League Rookie of the Year. And so we're going to be talking about some of those different things, the year that was, some of the different happenings going on around the warehouse this offseason. And we're also going to hear from a lot of great guests. We're going to have different contributors to the broadcast. We're going to hear from writers and players and Mike Elias and Orioles manager Brandon Hyde. Full show tonight. We've got a lot of different guests that we're going to turn to. First, we're going to hear from Ben McDonald. He's going to come up in the next couple of minutes. Ben is coming back from a hunting trip. He's on his way back from Nebraska, so I'm not exactly sure where Ben is, but we're going to find out a little bit more about that, and we're going to hear some of his takes and some of the early moves that have been made. Jordan Lyles' option, for instance, not being picked up, so we're going to talk to Ben a little bit about that and a couple of other pitching-related topics going into this upcoming year. We're going to hear from our insider, Roch. If you're going to be talking about free agency and you're going to be talking about some of the different moves going on, you got to hear from Roch. So he'll be coming up at the bottom part of the hour. There are two Orioles players who right now are in the Arizona Fall League doing really well. Noah DeNoyer ended up starting the Fall Stars game for the American League on Sunday out in Arizona, and his teammate Heston Kjerstad was also part of that starting lineup for the American League. We're going to hear from him coming up in the 8 o'clock hour, and then also at the bottom part of the 8 o'clock hour, we're going to hear from Orioles Director of Player Development, Matt Blood, touching on just about Kjerstad's development, how he has been doing, and we're also going to get a sense for what life is like for him at this time of the year. And finally, we're going to hear from our buddy Scotty Garceau, who does Orioles radio and television and pre and post, and get his take on some different things that happen over the course of the year. But as we said, it figures to be an exciting postseason, exciting offseason. The general manager's meetings just finish up, and while he was there, Mike Elias spoke to MLB Network.
I think that we're going to get started with addressing our major league needs as soon as possible here now that the World Series is over and we're at the GM meetings and the quiet period's ending in a few days. I expect a very active offseason for us. It's going to be a lot different than the rebuilding kind of off seasons that I've had since I've been here. So we're really excited now about kind of turning our focus towards augmenting this growing core that we're seeing at the major league level. In what shape, size, or form that's coming in, I don't really know yet. We're just going to go out into the market and try to make some wise acquisitions.
Yeah, teams have had opportunities today to extend some different qualifying offers to players, so that's something that the Orioles will certainly be keeping in mind as well, because if you get one of those players in free agency that's attached to a draft pick, you have to keep in mind what type of options you have down on the farm, and then possible trading partners as well. So a lot of different things can happen, but it's going to be exciting from the standpoint is that the Orioles, they're going to be involved. Lift off from here is what Mike Elias said during the year. So we can't wait for that all to get started. We're going to talk a little bit more about the offseason with Roch Kubatko and some of the different things that he is hearing a little bit later on. But when we return, Don't know where he is, but we're going to find out in a few minutes. Ben McDonald is going to join us next. This is the Orioles Hot Stove on WBAL News Radio 1090 and FM 101.5.
The Orioles Hot Stove Show with Geoff Arnold continues. This is WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL radio app.
1-2 pitch, ran it back, strike three at the top of the zone. It was a sinker that started on the corner, ran back towards the middle. Sheets is frozen, and Lyles a 1-2-3 fifth, and his second strikeout. That was Jordan Lyles, and as we know, the option on Jordan Lyles was not picked up. That was announced just a couple of days ago. Geoff Arnold back with you on the Orioles Hot Stove Show. It's me, it's Big Al Hildebile here in the MASN studios, and then Ryan Chell is producing as well. And if we're going to talk a little bit of Jordan Lyles and Orioles pitching, well, there are a couple people we could turn to, but we're turning to choose to a man who is somewhere between Nebraska and Baton Rouge, Louisiana. So where in the world is Ben McDonald? Let's bring him in. Big Ben, first of all, are you driving with your seatbelt fastened? Where are you right now?
Doc, how are you tonight, man? I'm doing good. Yes, I have my seatbelt fastened. Unfortunately, it has gotten dark, which makes it more difficult to drive, so I've slowed down just a little bit. I did get a fast driving certificate going through Nebraska, so I have slowed down anyway as I make my way. But I've come through Missouri, and I'm getting to northern Arkansas now as I continue on home. I got about 10 hours left. I won't make that all in one trip. I'm going to drive another couple hours tonight probably and find a hotel bed somewhere and get a good night's sleep and drive the rest of the way in tomorrow.
Well, just be on the lookout for deer and any objects in the roads or something like that. I don't want you to go off the roads as you're talking to us. But Big Ben, as we kind of heard the highlight of Jordan Lyles coming back, I wanted to start off with him. What was your take on his option not being picked up and him getting a $1 million buyout?
Yeah, you know, I was kind of hoping that the Orioles would pick up his option. Just because, I mean, if you look forward to next year, to 2023, you know, he's probably the only guy that you have in that rotation as of right now. I think you could count on for, you know, 32 or 33 starts. Obviously, he did it with the Rangers 2 years ago through 180 innings and, you know, opted out of his last start of the year after having a fabulous year. He was an innings eater again this year for the Orioles. And we know the Orioles bullpen got used, you know, towards the top of Major League Baseball this year. So you got to have those inning eater guys out there. I'm hoping that they can strike a deal with him in some other way now that they didn't pick up the option. Maybe there's a chance to bring him back, you know, in another way to get him back. But, you know, if you look forward, you know, Tyler Wells didn't put in a full year. Kyle Bradish wasn't up for a full year. You know, D.L. Hall, Grayson Rodriguez has had some injuries the last couple of years. I don't think that they could put a full year in for you. You know, Dean Kramer pitched two-thirds of a season this year, you know. And so I think you're going to need a guy that can come in there and chew up innings for you. I think it's valuable to have a guy like that that saves some innings in the bullpen and those types of things. Now, what does that mean going forward? Do they take that money they were going to spend on him and they go out and try to get another free agent pitcher, maybe another horse that can chew some innings up for you as well? We will have to wait and see as the free agent market really started today, I guess. And so we'll see what that brings in the offseason. I'm excited about it because, you know, Mike Elias said that it's liftoff time. They're going to be more aggressive in the free agent market this year. We don't know what that means as far as what degree that means, but I think there's a big need for the Orioles in depth in the rotation as far as guys who can go out and chew up starts for you.
Do you think, Ben, that maybe with that option not being picked up and the Orioles as they look at their pitching staff and just some of the youth that's associated with it and also realizing that, you know, John Means had Tommy John surgery, Tyler Wells, he ends up missing some time throughout the year, but you made it through okay on account of injuries. Knowing that and also knowing how many innings Lyles ate up, do you think that when the Orioles are go out and maybe getting starting pitching, is it that they need one or do maybe they need two?
No, I think you need two of those guys. If you look around the league, you look at the teams that made the playoffs this year, each team felt like to me while they had good bullpens, but they also had some guys that could go out there and chew up innings, right? And you save your bullpen along the way by doing that. But I think you got to have two of those guys that you can count on, you know, pretty much every night to give you six or six and a third every time out. It really shortens the game to be able to do that. It's okay to have a few guys that, you know, you're going to take your time with, like a Grayson Rodriguez, who I expect to break camp with the Orioles this year. But again, you know, he was hurt this year. He's never pitched more than about 110 innings in his minor league career. How far can you stretch him? Can you stretch him to 150 innings? You know, can you stretch Kyle Bradish? Can you stretch Dean Kramer to those types of innings? We don't know that. We know the Orioles have been very cautious. I think they're going to be very cautious with a D.L. Hall. I think they're going to be cautious with a Grayson Rodriguez. I think Tyler Wells learned a lot this year about, you know, how to get in shape, how to stay in shape, what it's going to take to be a starter. Being a bullpen guy is one thing, Doc, but being a starter that's going to go out there for 32 times out and give you 150 to 180 innings, it's a whole different animal to be able to do that. It takes a special kind of guy, and you got to have your body in really good shape to be able to go out there and do that. Jordan Lyles is that guy that's been able to do it 2 years in a row now. He's been able to go out there and chew up innings. So there is a lot of value in that. He had a phenomenal year this year. I think it was 13 or 14, you know, quality starts. He came in, and I was skeptical of Jordan Lyles. I mean, look, he came in with a career ERA of 5.1 throughout his 10 big league career. But this year he pitched it really well. Now, some people say, well, yeah, he pitched in Oriole Park, and it's a pitcher's park now. And sure, that helped along the way, but also felt like he pitched. Like, he's a veteran guy that knows how to get himself out of jams, knows how to extend himself to get you a little more length at times. And I think it's valuable to have at least two of those guys in your rotation because, look, the goal for the Orioles is to get to the playoffs, you know. And I think it was the Tampa Bay Rays won 86 games this year. I think they were the last American League team that got in. The Orioles won 83. So they're knocking on the door. The question is, can they figure out a way to get to, like, 88 wins next year? I think that's probably what it's going to take in the American League to get into the playoffs next year. Well, how do you do that? You got to do it with pitching. And that was the big part of the Orioles this year was the pitching. Obviously, the bullpen was the backbone. It was the strength of the Orioles. I think we had a top 10 bullpen in all of baseball this year. The guys were phenomenal. But the truth is, I felt like some of those bullpen guys, not their fault, but they were used a lot. And it's not Brandon Hyde's fault. It's just because the starters just didn't give enough length at times to be able to rest those guys accordingly. And that's why having two or three guys that can give you some length is so important.
How important do you think it is to maybe also get a guy or two who is a veteran relief pitcher who you can throw maybe 3 days in a row? Because that's something that we know Brandon Hyde is not wanted to do in the past. It was because there just wasn't a reason to do it. This year, because of the usage, you want to try and protect those guys. But when you're in a pennant chase and you get to September, how important is to maybe have one or two veteran bullpen guys who you can just use a little bit more and you don't have to be nervous about sending them out there 3 days in a row?
I think it's huge. You know, I mean, you talk about Felix Bautista, a guy that did this for the first time in his big league career. What a year that he had, you know. But you had to be careful with him because he had never done it before. You know, CNL Perez, Brian Baker, all of them had outstanding years. He hoped that they could do it again next year. But it would be wonderful to have another veteran bullpen arm in the back end that's done there. He's been there. He's done it before. And he can give you a pitch back-to-back days or maybe pitch 3 days in a row if you need that. So I think the Orioles have a wonderful nucleus, obviously. But I think there's some big-time needs for the Orioles, too. I think a starting pitcher is a big-time need. I think another veteran bullpen arm is a big-time need. And I think you need another middle-of-the-park bat, too, Geoff. I mean, I just, you know, when you talk about the AL East, you talk about teams that score runs. And you have to be able to bang in the AL East to be able to compete. You got to score runs. And we know the Orioles struggled at times this year to score runs. And so, you know, pitching and defense was the key this year. It was really good. I expect the defense to be equally as good next year. I mean, Jorge Mateo, Ramon Urias were outstanding. I think they'll be good again next year as well. But you got to be able to go out and score runs, too. And that's going to be a big part of it. You look at the Astros, who won the World Series this year. They didn't have a whole lot of weaknesses. You know, they had a wonderful starting rotation. They had a big-time bullpen. They could play defense. you know, they can score runs and they can beat you a lot of different ways. And I think that's what it takes over the course of 162 games to be able to win games in different ways, you know. And the Orioles offense shined at times this year, but we all know hitting at runners in scoring position was a struggle for the Orioles this year. They had some good spurts in there for a month or two. They'd hit it pretty good. But for the most part, they struggled to score runs and hit with runners in scoring position, you know. And so I think it's going to be important. Now, where do you put that piece? I don't know. I don't know how that's going to work out. How do you put the pieces of the puzzle together? But it feels like the Orioles need another middle of the yard bat to really get over the top.
He is Ben McDonald. Please drive safely as you're making your way home to Baton Rouge. Also, real quick, are you still riding high after that LSU win over Alabama? I enjoyed your Twitter post. You seemed like you were having some fun with your buddies when they were able to pull it off.
Yeah, I got a little bit excited, Jeff. I'll be honest with you.
Just a little.
How could you not get excited? Just a little. I got a little bit excited and was enjoying some adult beverages that night and watching the ball game like a lot of people were. And so I got a little bit excited. But, yeah, it was a big win for LSU, obviously, and kind of overachieving in some ways. And so it's not often we knock off Alabama, you know. And so to beat Alabama, especially at home, was a big win for the Tigers. So they positioned themselves pretty good. And they finish up here. They'll play in the SEC championship game, which is a huge accomplishment for a first-year coach to be able to do that. So I'm excited for the Tigers and always enjoy beating Alabama for sure.
Can't blame you for that. Ben, really appreciate you doing this. Travel safe, and we'll talk soon.
All right, good talking to you, Jeff. Take care, buddy.
All right, buddy. So in a little while, we're going to hear from Roch Kubatko. We're going to take a break first, though, and have more when we return. This is the Orioles Hot Stove Show, WBL News Radio 1090 and FM 101.5.
Keep it here during the offseason for the latest news and updates on Birds baseball. This is the Orioles Hot Stove Show on WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL radio app.
Well, he's been a popular guy with other teams since I've been here, but look, we like him. He was batted third for us all year. He can play a really solid right field. He's great in the clubhouse, switch hitting DH. He goes well with Adley in the middle of the lineup and the other guys that we have coming. So we see no real strategy in moving him, and I'm excited he's coming back for the next 2 years. But, you know, obviously we do our jobs and we listen to people.
That's Orioles Executive Vice President and General Manager Mike Elias talking at the GM meetings about Anthony Santander, who had a career season with the Orioles this year. We're going to talk a little bit more about him in just a bit. But first, give the gift of opening day this holiday season with a Birdland membership. Buy any Birdland membership now and receive priority access to opening day tickets starting Thursday, December 8th. Surprise the O's fan in your life this holiday season with opening day tickets versus the Yankees. Learn more at Orioles.com/memberships. Geoff Arnold here with you. We're going to hear from Heston Kjerstad in the 8 o'clock hour. We're also going to hear from Orioles Director of Player Development, Matt Blood, in about an hour or so, plus Scotty Garceau in there as well. But if we're going to kick off Orioles Hot Stove season, at least Hot Stove season, because this is the first time we're doing the Hot Stove show this year, it's got to include our buddy Roch Kubatko of MASNSports.com. Roch, What has been going on with you since the season wrapped up?
I'll say, first of all, if it's going to get into the 40s on Saturday, it's Sunday, it's hot stove season officially now. I didn't realize we were dropping that much. I've just been packing.
Roch, I'm wearing shorts right now, so I can understand where you're coming from.
That is a violent drop from the 70s today, I would tell you. But yeah, I mean, it's, you know, the quiet period is over. It wasn't completely silent, but obviously at the beginning of the offseason after the last regular season game. October is usually pretty quiet for the teams that aren't in the playoffs, but there were some minor moves made. The 40-man roster had a few adjustments made, but you could just tell things were already picking up. And some of the stuff was procedural, like, you know, getting guys declaring for free agency 5 days after the World Series, John Means coming off the 60-day injured list today, going back on the 40. But I just feel like pretty much every day or every other day I'm suddenly – writing a second story during the afternoon. So it definitely feels like things are picking up a little bit.
Yeah, I was going to say, is for you this more of an exciting offseason to cover from your perspective, just considering where the Orioles are after a pretty impressive 2022?
examine the word exciting. In a sense, yes, because there is going to be, I think, more activity now and more to write, more to report, pursue, as opposed to in the past where, like we used to joke, you know, the winter meetings, you go there to come back with a Rule 5 pick or two, and then a lot of times you would just wait for a few, you know, minor league signing, spring invites type thing. But it looks like they're going to be much busier. Now, the flip side of that or whatever, that double-edged sword, is you have a lot more national media attention now, which means even more rumors to chase than normal. I've already seen that, you know, people have the Orioles as being a good fit for like 7 or 8 of the top 10 free agents. And I'm like, well, here we go. We already have our first Carlos Correa rumors. So it's going to be, it adds to the workload a little bit selfishly to have to chase all of these and not sure whose blue check is legit anymore on Twitter. But hey, it's better than the team not being deemed, you know, significant or worth anybody's time during the really bad times here. It's you know, so it is going to be interesting to have the team being more active and in on, which is another popular phrase in the offseason, in on more guys than they have been in the past.
We're with Masson's Roch Kubatko. Let's start with Jordan Lyles. Option was declined. Does that maybe open the door to a bigger free agent pitcher signing, or maybe possibly adding two starting pitchers to help out a group of talented youngsters?
Well, I feel like now especially it's got to be two. All along they've been looking to add more of a frontline one or two type starter, whatever they did with Jordan Lyles, but not bringing him back, you've got to, at least for now, the door is still open. They could double back to him later in the offseason, but for now at least you got to find a replacement for him as well. Because as you know, Geoff, you never have enough starting pitching. And you have to have the depth. You have to cover yourself in case there's some regression from some of these younger guys. There's an injury. John Means is not going to be back. We don't know till when. Not April. Probably not May. Maybe June, they're hoping. So, you know, you have to have multiple guys here, and then you figure it out later. I mean, on paper, it's like, well, that's more than five with the guys that are coming back. But, again, you can't have too many. I just feel like with Lyles, and I had no idea which way they were going to go with this, I see the logic in not committing, which would come out to $10 million right now on him, if you include the $1 million buyout. And again, if he's still in the market later in the winter and they haven't filled that other spot, because you are going to be looking for a Jordan Lyles type, then maybe you go back to him. But you know, you don't want to necessarily make that financial commitment right now. And, you know, it was the second week of November, not knowing how much you're really going to have to spend and increase the payroll to get that frontline starter, the big bat you're looking for, whether it's free agency, whether it's taking on a bigger contract from another team that they haven't been willing to do in the past, and they are now. So I can see that logic. The gamble, of course, is if, you know, suddenly another team, you know, scoops them up and Lyles is off the market, and then you realize, hey, we could have used that guy because of the value he did bring, not just the leadership, not just the innings eater. He had 13 quality starts, and that was in a season where everybody was slow played in April after the lockout. You know, he was shut down before his final start, the last day of the season. He could have increased that total. So he was valuable in other ways as well. So there is a certain gamble there, but I see the logic in holding off before you commit that kind of money, because there are so many questions they still have as far as how much they're going to have to spend otherwise.
We're with Roch Kubatko. The trade market is also something that's possible for the Orioles. And Mike Elias said it a few days ago, and we just heard it actually coming back from the segment, that Anthony Santander, he doesn't view him as maybe be going anywhere. But if the market is a little bit tougher, maybe on the pitching side of things, do you think there's any way that perspective changes? Or do you think that based on what Mike said the other day at the GM meetings, that he's going to hold pretty true to that?
I mean, I think, you know, he left himself an out there at the end. You always listen. And it's your due diligence, as they say. It's front office malpractice, as Andy McPhail used to call it, if you didn't do something like that. If some team is willing to overwhelm you with an offer for Anthony Santander, especially if it's a frontline starting pitcher, you have to at least consider it. I think he was trying to make the point, and some of it has been driven by the media, that, you know, because we're always calling Anthony Santander a trade chip and his value has never been higher, and there's been a lot of interest in him in the past, and there wasn't this last trade deadline. I feel like he wanted to get the word out there that, look, we're not actively shopping Anthony Santander, and it, you know, we're looking for a big bat. Why would you want to subtract a guy who hit 33 home runs and has power from both sides of the plate, you know, is good in the field, is a leader in that clubhouse, improved his on-base skills, actually started drawing walks. Who would have thought he'd be second in the team in walks behind Adley Rutschman? So, you know, that's his value's high, but it's also very high to the Orioles. Other teams like him, but they like him as well. So I think he wanted to make that point. We're not looking to move him necessarily, but you always leave yourself a little wiggle room there because if a team like the Marlins, for example, that really liked him in the past, come to you and offer one of those young starting, controllable starting pitchers and whatever, you have to at least listen and consider that. Now, that may not happen, but you certainly never close the door publicly and say, hey, this guy's untouchable, and possibly lose an opportunity at a deal that you can't pass up. So they're not actively shopping them, but they will listen, pretty much anybody, because that's what the front office does. What obviously fans have to remember is if you hear that there have been any talks, don't automatically assume a guy is being actively shopped and you're trying to move them. You're just listening. You're listening in on. You'll always answer the phone, but that doesn't mean that necessarily they're looking to move Santander. And as I said, to subtract a big bat like that when you're looking to improve the lineup would seem to be counterproductive on the surface.
Rock, we got to wrap this up real quickly. Brandon Hyde up for American League Manager of the Year, and then Adley Rutschman up for American League Rookie of the Year. How do you handicap their chances going into next week?
I think Hyde's the favorite, but Francona is going to get a lot of support. He had the youngest roster in baseball. Not as strong a division, but nonetheless ended up running away with it. I think Hyde still wins it. I think Rutschman's going to finish behind Julio Rodriguez, who just won a Silver Slugger Award as well with Seattle. I think he is the favorite. Any other year, Rutschman's chances would be a lot better. I think he's going to end up being runner-up, but I certainly think Hyde will get that award and is certainly deserving of it.
No question about it. When you have a 31-win difference from a year ago, a lot of people have to take notice. Everybody has taken notice of the Orioles. Rock, really appreciate it, my man, and make sure that you check over those floor plans to the winter meetings before you get out to that hotel where they're being held, because I know that's something that stresses you out a little bit. So make sure you're doing your due diligence before you make it out to San Diego.
I've already got my path mapped out of how I'm going to walk the lobby, so we're good.
It's all about preparation, Rock. It's all about prep.
It is.
All right, buddy. Thanks so much.
Thanks, man.
That was MASN's Roch Kubatko. In a little bit, we're going to hear from Heston Kjerstad, talk about his time in the Arizona Fall League. But that is coming up at the top of the hour, and we're going to talk some more Orioles baseball when we return. It's the first Orioles Hot Stove show of the off-season, and you are hearing it right here on WBAL News Radio 1090 and FM 101.5.
Give the gift of opening day with a Birdland membership. Buy any Birdland membership now and receive priority access to opening day tickets versus the Yankees. Go to Orioles.com/memberships. Now, more of the Hot Stove Show on WBAL News Radio 1090 and FM 101.5.
Hey, O's fans, be among the first to receive breaking news straight from the team by following the Orioles on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube. Plus, you can connect with the Oriole Bird on Twitter, at Oriole Bird, to learn about all of his community appearances and activities. Learn more at Orioles.com/connect. Geoff Arnold with you. This is the first Hot Stove show of the year that we're doing, and we're really excited to be bringing the show to you every Thursday, 7 to 9 o'clock. Last couple of shows, it sounds like, are going to be done down in Sarasota. There's some weeks where I'm going to do it. There's some weeks where our buddy, William Brett Hollander, is going to be here. There's some weeks where we're going to do it together. For instance, when the Orioles have the winter meetings going on, Brett and I will tag team some of those shows. So really excited to be working with Brett on this. Especially fun off season that the Orioles are going into, coming off a huge year where you add 31 wins, you get Adley Rutschman up to the major leagues, you had another great debut from Gunnar Henderson, guys having career years left and right, and you were in it until October the 1st when the Orioles made it all the way past the midnight hour of October. Before they were eliminated from playoff contention, but they were the last team out, and it's fun to think about what they could be in 2023. So we've had an opportunity so far to hear from Ben McDonald, our buddy who is driving along, and he is on his way back from a hunting trip. So we heard from him, talk some pitching. We also just heard from Roch, Kubatko, and we're going to hear from Heston Kjerstad in a little bit. Scotty Garceau is coming up around 8:15, and then Orioles Director of Player Development, Matt Blood, will join us at 8:30. Some of the different takeaways, and we did talk about Jordan Lyles with both Ben and Roch. You know, Roch was saying that it wasn't necessarily a guarantee that they were going to pick up his option. I think that a bunch of us came away thinking we're not really sure how this is going to go. Regardless, it was a solid season for Lyles. 4.42 ERA, picks up 12 wins, 179 innings pitched for Jordan. So that was one short of a career high. He had one inning more with the Texas Rangers the year before. But even though he gets the $1 million buyout, there's always a chance that he could end up back on this pitching staff because, you know, guys who eat up the amount of innings that Lyles has and that are as durable as he is, they don't exactly grow on trees. And he had a big effect on the pitching staff. There's so many guys that they called him dad. And while Jordan, I think, would probably tell you that he wasn't dad necessarily, he didn't act like dad. He was there to answer questions and help out a lot of the younger guys with things they were trying to do. Kyle Bradish cited it. Tyler Wells talked about it time and time again about how he picked Lyles' brain. Sometimes bother him a little bit, but that's what Jordan was there for. And I think he understood that he wanted some of these different Orioles pitchers' experiences to be different than his experience when Jordan was coming up as a young player in the major leagues. And he certainly did that. And then the other thing that we heard from both Ben and from Roch is, you know, there is the possibility that it's not just one starter who gets added. It's possibly two starting pitchers who get added. And, you know, next year, talk of Grayson Rodriguez, D.L. Hall, both being members of the starting rotation. But remember, it's a really long season. The Orioles were fortunate in many ways on the injury front this year. And Grayson Rodriguez, great year, 75 and two-thirds innings. D.L. Hall, 84 and a third innings. So you have to make sure to keep that in mind. And there's just a lot of ground to cover. And you want to make sure you're taking care of these young guys because they are your future, and they are going to play a big role for you down the line. So having some veteran starting pitchers, and it might be more than one to help you out, is something that we have heard, and is something that we heard Ben say as well as Roch say too. And another thing you got to remember is, you know, a lot of Orioles are up for some awards right now. Adley Rutschman, Rookie of the Year, he figures to have a pretty darn good chance. And then you also have Brandon Hyde up for American League Manager of the Year. When you win 31 more games than the year before, you're going to catch people's attention, and Brandon Hyde certainly has. So a lot to come still on the Orioles Hot Stove Show. We have got, in very short order, Heston Kjerstad coming up, but we will take a break and be right back after this.
Now, the Baltimore Orioles Hot Stove Show with Geoff Arnold. This is your home for Birds Baseball. WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL Radio app.
Full size.
Meantime, Myrick has issued two walks, and one of them might come around to score. As Kjerstad singles to right, Scott will come around to score. And the American League extends their lead to 3-1.
Yeah, it was Heston Kjerstad, Orioles prospect, in the Arizona Fall League Fall Stars game, which was on Sunday. And we're going to be hearing from Heston in just a minute. But first, hey, Orioles fans, now there's a credit card designed just for you. With the new Orioles Clubhouse Rewards MasterCard, you earn points with every purchase. Then redeem those points for great stuff, including game tickets, merchandise, and once-in-a-lifetime experiences like throwing out a first pitch, taking batting practice at Camden Yards, or meeting your favorite player. To learn more and apply, just visit Orioles.com/Clubhouse Rewards. So as we said, Heston Kjerstad is with us on the Orioles Hot Stove Show. Heston, Geoff Arnold with you here for the Orioles Hot Stove Show. Thanks so much for taking a couple of minutes with us. How has it been in the Arizona Fall League?
Oh, for sure. Thanks for having me. Oh, the Fall League's been awesome. You know, it's a lot of good players out here, a lot of competition, so no, it's fun to go out there and face competition like that every day and just keep improving as a player and getting better.
Would you say that this is probably the best competition that you have seen? I mean, this is your first real taste of professional baseball this year. Out in Arizona, is it some of the best pitching that you've had a chance to see?
Oh, without a doubt. You know, you've always seen really good arms or elite arms and the best of the best from time to time. But out here, everything's a little bit more concentrated. Everybody's a little bit better, a little bit more refined and everything. So it's fun to be able to compete against that every day.
We're with Orioles prospect Heston Kjerstad, who's rated number 9 in the Orioles system by MLB Pipeline. We're going to hear from Matt Blood, the Orioles director from player development, coming up at about 8:30 or so. What was this year like? First time that you'd gotten to play baseball since 2020. How did it start, and kind of how have you seen your progression from the very beginning to where you are right now?
Oh, for sure. You know, not the start I was planning on. Had a hamstring injury in spring training that kept me out for the first half of the season, but finally got back out there in June, and you know, it was a lot of fun just to get back out there, play every day, and also just enjoying the challenges of baseball and just trying to get better every day, and also seeing yourself progress throughout the season. You had your high points, your low points, and then just being able to go through them and learning as a player to get better and just using those things to help better me in my career.
You missed time on account of myocarditis, which is obviously a very scary thing. And I'm sure that it had a lot of different consequences, and that, you know, you probably lost weight and you had to get yourself back into baseball shape and not seeing pitching. Do you feel like you are right now in a good spot? Do you feel like you're fully back physically and in a position where you want to be?
Oh, 100%. I feel like I'm in a great spot where I'm at, being able to play the way I have been and finish out the season healthy. But, you know, also, you know, I want to be better than what I am now. I want to be a better player all the way around. So, yes, I'm happy with where I'm at, but I also know there's new levels in my game that I want to reach and achieve, and that I'm going to strive for through the off season and coming in the next season too.
You're with one of your teammates in the minors, in Noah Denoyer, who started actually the game that you also played in on Sunday, the Fall Stars game. What can you tell us about Noah Denoyer? Because it seemed like he had a pretty impressive year on the farm himself.
Oh yeah, no, he had a really good season. You know, he's a really good pitcher, and you know, he knows how to command his pitch as well. He throws them where he wants to, and you know, he keeps the ball down in the zone with his off speed and everything, and gets a lot of ground balls out. And as y'all know, he also gets a good amount of strikeouts too, for sure.
There's no doubt about that. Last one for me, Heston. We're with Heston Kjerstad. Where do you want to be at the start of next year? What's the goal kind of going into the off season, and where you want to be at the beginning of 2023?
For me, you know, it's just being healthy and playing baseball. Wherever it is, you know, that's after things I've been through, that's all I can ask for, is to be healthy and playing the game and just having fun, honestly. That's all I hope for every season. So,
well, it's been a lot of fun watching you. You've had a great run. You've been among the best in the Fall League this year. Congratulations on all the success, making it through the entire year, and we look forward to catching up with you down at spring training.
For sure. Sounds good. Thanks for having me. Good talking with you, and for sure visit with y'all again in the future. Appreciate it.
That is Orioles prospect Heston Kjerstad. Still more to come on the Orioles Hot Stove Show. We said that we're going to hear from Orioles Director of Player Development Matt Blood in just a bit, but up next, Scotty Garceau is going to stop by and talk about the season. This is the Orioles Hot Stove Show on WBAL News Radio 1090 and FM 101.5.
Follow the Orioles on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube. Learn more at orioles.com/connect. Now back to the Orioles Hot Stove Show on WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL radio app.
1-1 pitch. Hit hard, way back, over the scoreboard, and gone! Rougned Odor walks it off. The Orioles with a walk-off home run for the second straight day. And they finally beat the Rays. It took 13 innings of hard work. Odor throws a kiss to the crowd and gets jumped on at home plate. Water everywhere. We saw a classic tonight, Brett.
There are a lot of nights like that this year at Camden Yards. A lot of walk-off wins. A lot of walk-off wins by different players. And a lot of just thrilling comeback wins for the Orioles late in games where they were never out of it. That was definitely part of the DNA of the 2022 Orioles. Geoff Arnold back with you on the Orioles Hot Stove Show here on WBAL News Radio. And the man on the call there is our buddy Scott Garceau of MASN. He also did work on the Orioles radio network for us, too. Got to work together a little bit. And if there is somebody who is very excited that it is November the 10th and the temperatures are still in the 60s and it's not getting into his golf game just yet, it has got to be Scott Garceau. You still hitting him straight out there, Scotty?
Some went straight today. There were one or two that went a little offline, but hey, it was a beautiful day. And I kind of looked at the long-range forecast and said, better get out today because it doesn't look very good. Highs in the 40s next week. I think fall is really going to arrive, but we've been lucky. Played the other day, we had Al Bumbry out at Bully Rock, and so take advantage of the weather while it's good.
Yeah, I texted you earlier today to see if you'd come on the show tonight, and I didn't hear from you right away, and I quickly
you knew.
Realized, oh, that's right. It's still warm outside, so somebody's on the link. So I'm glad to hear that you're enjoying yourself. We enjoyed calling Orioles baseball this year. A truly exciting season. One of the best turnaround season from one year to the next in the divisional era across all of baseball. We heard your walk-off call a moment there from Rougned Odor. That was back in May. I think it was the day before Adley Rutschman made his major league debut. But for you, was there a most exciting moment?
There were so many of those dramatic finishes this year that it's hard to put a finger on one. You're better at that than me going back and pulling out games and highlights. But it was just this, and you mentioned one of the great turnaround seasons in Oriole history. And for old-timers like me, it reminded me a lot of 1989, the Why Not summer. That was one of the classic years of Oriole baseball, where that 88 team set a record for losses. And that was the year they started 0-21 and made a lot of national news because of that. And then they came back in 89 with this phenomenal young hustling team that just kept making plays and stayed in the pennant race, had the lead much of the way. And there weren't as many wild cards back then, but they went to Toronto the final weekend of the season where they had a chance to win a series and win the division, and they came up just inches short. But that was reminiscent of this year because it was so unexpected. And I think we all probably believed in the Mike Elias plan where he had to kind of strip it down, build it from the bottom up. But myself, you, and I think anybody else that followed this club didn't think it would happen quite this quick. Thought maybe what we saw last year was a year or two later down the road, but it was phenomenal to see so many young players. You mentioned Adley coming up, and then later on in the season to see young guys contributing and know they're going to be part of the future for a long time. It was a special, special season.
We're with Scott Garceau of MASN and the Orioles Radio Network. How do you quantify the impact, Scott, that Brandon Hyde has had over these last 3 years? Because I remember when we arrived and we kind of wandered off into the wilderness a little bit in that it was COVID and it was different and there's really no playbook on how to handle that if you're Brandon Hyde. And he went from there and then from the year before, as we know too, to turning this thing all the way around. So how much of this turnaround and the fact that it's maybe a little ahead of schedule has to do with Brandon Hyde?
Well, I think he gets a big chunk of it. Obviously, the architect is Mike Elias, who's building it, but the guy that was working it out on the field and had to kind of sacrifice himself and he knew it was going to be tough when he signed up for the job. He knew what he was going to go through. But if you're close to the team, you realize that the players had his respect. They respected Brandon. And when I was asked over the last couple of years, hey, what do you think about Hyde? I said, when his team is good as the team as he's playing, I'll tell you how good of a manager is. Because back then, night after night, his team wasn't as good as the guys he was lining up against. And last year was the first time where he had a chance to really manage. You know, he mentioned last year at one point somebody asked him about that. You know, now you're competitive, you've got better players, and, you know, the farm system's getting better. He said, you know, the year before, he said, we were just trying to survive. He said, we'd go into a game and they'd tell me I had like four guys in the bullpen that night. That was it, because, you know, the night before the starter went 2 1/3 and they gave up 7 or 8 runs early, and we had to spend the bullpen. So it wasn't a matter of matchups the next night. It was a matter of surviving, because now you got the next night to play, right? And there were so many times where that bullpen was so short, they were beat up, and then you throw in a few injuries as the season gets rolling along. But last year, he had a chance to do that. He had guys in the bullpen in the middle and late innings that he could bring in and match up, and guys like Perez, he had a left-hander out there that he could come in and get three hitters out who could pitch in the sixth, seventh, eighth, or ninth inning. And now you had some weapons out there, and we saw what he was able to do with them. And now he's a candidate for manager of the year. So yeah, I think he's got a lot to do with their success, and hopefully he'll be around for a while.
He would be the fourth Orioles manager to win American League Manager of the Year if he is so named next week. Wrapping things up here with our buddy Scott Garceau. Scott, in terms of biggest needs for the Orioles this offseason, you know, the free agent signing period just got underway at 5 o'clock today after the quiet period following the World Series. To you, what do you think the biggest need or needs are?
Yeah, it is interesting, because I don't think there's anything glaring. Look at the club, and Rutschman's behind the plate. I think you can improve with a backup catcher there. Mountcastle's going to be at first base for a long time. The infield, except for second base, looks pretty well set. I think McTeo had a fantastic year. We know he can do stealing bases. He showed some pop at times. Yeah, the average isn't great, but the defense was gold glove caliber. I think you got guys on the horizon like Westberg. Kowser even could be a contributor this year. The outfield looks fairly set if they come back with the same guys. Hayes is that guy that had a brilliant first half, probably would have been the MVP if we voted at the All-Star break, and then tailed off with some injuries in the second half. But he's that center fielder that can play left field in the new Camden Yards, right, where, Geoff, you know it. You need a center fielder out in left field now. That's a very important defensive position, and Austin Hayes was great out there. So Hayes, Mullins, and Santander, who hit 33 homers last year in the outfield, and then you want to see more. You got Kyle Stowers, right? Big home run power. We got to see a little bit of him. He played in bits and pieces. Does he factor in? Is he competing for a starting job? Is he the fourth outfielder that plays a lot, does some DHing, plays some defense? So by the positions, I think they're fairly set. You can't have too much pitching in this game. And we just watched the Astros win the World Series. Had some great starters, but that bullpen was just so lights out. If you can add another big arm to the bullpen to go with the guys that came and had career years, Batista, we mentioned, Perez last year. Brian Baker had some moments where he seemed like he was unhittable. So you're building some good things, but I think the great teams have pitching and they have depth at pitching. So if you can add there, they didn't renew Lyles, which, you know, I thought that was kind of a jump ball because you got some young arms. You know, you're probably going to take a look at Grayson Rodriguez this year. Can D.L. Hall crack the rotation? Very interesting, but you know, I think Mike's going to be aggressive. I think they'll make some moves. They could trade prospects for a frontline pitcher. That's a possibility. But in my humble opinion, you can never have too much pitching in this game. The great teams all have it.
You brought up the Astros and how they pitched and just how much better they were than so many teams across baseball this year. So you bring up a good point there. Another big reason for all the Orioles' success this year was the defense that they played too. Scott Garceau, continue to enjoy your time on the links, And
I think that's drying up. I'm going to have to start heading south, I think.
Well, hopefully the wind's going to blow in the right direction and keep you inside the navigational beacons.
All right. I like your attitude. Be good, Geoff.
All right, Scotty. We'll talk to you soon. That is Scott Garceau. He does work with us on the Orioles Radio Network as well as MASN. Still a bunch of stuff coming up in the Orioles Hot Stove show tonight. We're going to talk a little bit more about some of the news that broke in terms of, or not news that broke, things that have been going on. But Matt Blood is going to be joining us next, Orioles Director of Player Development, after the news on WBAL News Radio.
This is the Orioles Hot Stove Show, the real and inside story on Birds Baseball. WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL Radio app.
My biggest goal is to, you know, try and, you know, achieve my potential, go out every day and focus on the process and just, you know, bringing that energy and, you know, learning from each day. So anytime I can do that, it's, you know, it's big and it's what I focus on. You know, it's the guys in this locker room and it's the memories and experiences that we have together that are going to be the things that we're talking about for the next 20 years.
Now, that is Adley Rutschman, who this year made his much-anticipated Major League debut, and it went very well. He is up for the American League Rookie of the Year Award, which is going to be announced next week. And overall, a lot of great success stories taking place on the Orioles farm. We heard from Orioles prospect Heston Kjerstad a little bit earlier on, and right now we're pleased to be joined by Matt Blood, who is the Orioles Director of Player Development. Matt, great to have you with us tonight. Geoff Arnold with you on the Orioles Hot Stove Show. How has your offseason been going so far?
Hey, Geoff. Good to be here. Thanks for having me. It's going great. Going really well. We're excited about the work we have in front of us and the potential to have a pretty fun year next year.
So for somebody like you who's a director of player development, free agency opening up, Arizona Fall League starting to wind down where you have some players there right now. But what is this time of year like for you as you're starting to get ready for spring training and begin planning for 2023?
Yeah, my role is a lot of positioning, hiring, and then positioning the coaches. And right now, thankfully, for the first time since I've been here, we have a lot of continuity. And so there's not quite as much hiring going on as what we've had in the past few years. So that gives us more time to really focus on planning an organization for our staff for the following year and just to make sure that we're all on the same page and providing the players with a very clear and consistent message.
You have a great staff, a lot of really talented people in your organization that – have some have made their way up to the major leagues like Ryan Fuller did last year. And Cody Ashe is actually joining the major league coaching staff as an offensive strategy coach. And he's worked with you all in the past. What can you tell us about Cody Ashe and what he brings to the table and hopefully what he'll be able to do for the major league team?
He's just a smart, thoughtful coach. You know, he's got the experience of playing and of struggling. And he's been through things that the players at that level experience, but he also thinks in a critical, humble way and just is very good at synthesizing information and then sort of communicating that to the players.
I know you take a lot of pride when minor leaguers get promoted to the major leagues. Is it the same level of pride and excitement when a member of one of your coaching staffs gets a similar opportunity?
it's a little bit of a double-edged sword for us because that means in the minor leagues we no longer are able to use that coach's services. But yes, we're very happy for Cody. We knew when we first brought him on in the minor leagues, and it wouldn't be very long before he would be up helping the major league staff. And it's also really good because now we have a lot of continuity between the major league staff and the minor league staff. a lot of very organic communication and understanding between the two entities, and then the players themselves, whenever they get to the major league team, they're going to be with coaches that they have experience with, and just really helps ease that transition.
We're with Matt Blood, who's the Orioles Director of Player Development. We're here on the Orioles Hot Stove Show. Matt, kind of across the minor leagues, there's a lot of success, a lot of great stories, players who you knew had big-time potential being right where they need to be, and then some players who really stood out and jumped forward and had really exciting years. But overall, from how things have gone this past year down on the Orioles farm, what was maybe one or two areas where you think you all took really nice strides?
I think in general, we took a big step forward in the implementation of our processes. I think we had staff that had been with us for at least a couple of years now, and our entire process just became more mature, and people understood it, and we implemented it, and we saw strides on in really all areas. In pitching, it was a little bit ahead of hitting in the past, and then our hitting, you know, this past year really took a big step forward. So I think we're pleased across the board with our staff and with the message that is being given to the players and our practice designs, and really just our goal is to provide the players with really good information and really good learning environments so that their development process is as efficient as possible. And I think we saw a lot of that occur this past season.
In some cases, those processes can help maybe somebody who has missed time and is trying to play a little bit of catch-up. We saw that with Heston Kjerstad this year, who is out in the Arizona Fall League right now. What did you see from Heston during the regular season, and what have the reports been from out in Arizona?
Yeah, we saw a player who had missed a lot of time and needed to get his legs back under him and just go play and see pitch. I mean, he was facing the toughest pitching he had ever seen in his life on a night-in, night-out basis, and it was just really awesome to see him out there competing. And he made it to high A, which is a very tough level to hit, and he held his own. And then he's been hitting the ball really hard and pretty far out in Arizona, and that's exciting. So hopefully this helps him come in next season even more prepared to make a push closer to where he's trying to go.
Be honest with you, I hadn't really heard of Noah DeNoyer before this year, and he starts in the Fall Stars game for the American League team on Sunday. What stands out about him? Because he seems like somebody that is a pretty darn good pitching prospect for the team, for the organization, and is somebody that seems like he's starting to get on people's radars right now.
He's done a great job. He worked really hard with our coaching staff to sort of refine a couple things in his arsenal, and he's had a lot of success recently. He's got a couple plus breaking balls, and his pitchability, and we're excited about DeNoyer, and it's nice to see him having success out in Arizona and platforming himself for the future.
We got to speak to Jordan Westberg when he won the Orioles Minor League Player of the Year Award. And then I also got to speak to Joey Ortiz, who's another really good infield prospect for the team, at a Birdland member event that was pretty recent here at Camden Yards. For both of those two really talented infield prospects, how close do you think they are to being ready to suit up and to play for the Orioles?
Well, they're one level away. They're in AAA. They played very well in AAA. Westberg got more time there than Ortiz, but they both played extremely well at the highest minor league level last season. They're both very qualified defenders. They can play multiple positions. They're both shortstops, but if they're called on to play second base or third base or even in the outfield, they can do that too at a high level. And they're just good all-around baseball players. And usually managers like players like that, and it's just a matter of time for when their numbers get called.
It's an impressive group. Matt, terrific season for you. Best of luck with everything that you have going on during the offseason. I know you don't get a whole lot of time off, but whatever time you do have a chance to get away, I hope you enjoy it, and I look forward to seeing you down at spring training.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me.
That is Matt Blood, the Orioles Director of Player Development. A little bit more to come on the Orioles Hot Stove Show. We'll talk a little bit about some of the things that we have heard tonight and then get you set up for next week's show. Tonight kicked it all off here on WBAL News Radio 1090, and we look forward to continuing to bring you coverage of Orioles baseball throughout the offseason. We will take a break and be right back with some more Orioles news in just a moment. This is Orioles Hot Stove on WBAL News Radio 1090 and FM 101.5.
The Orioles Hot Stove Show with Geoff Arnold continues. This is WBAL News Radio 1090, FM 101.5, and the WBAL radio app.
I think this is the year that people are noticing what a talented manager that we have in Baltimore. But for me, this has been 4 years. I mean, we've been very process-oriented, like Brandon said. He's been working with the front office to build the entire organization. So this isn't something that's like new for me in 2022, but obviously he's gotten national attention, and rightfully so, for the performance of the team. And for me, more so the style of play that I think we see from these players. And so I think this is a good year for him to win it. But in my mind, it's for the last 4 years. And hopefully many more.
And Brandon Hyde very well could be the fourth manager in Orioles history to win a Manager of the Year award. He was already named the Sporting News American League Manager of the Year earlier on. And we're going to find out on Tuesday if he won. We're going to find out on Monday if Adley Rutschman is going to become the sixth Oriole to win an American League Rookie of the Year award. Exciting times right now. Geoff Arnold back with you on the Orioles Hot Stove Show. It's been a fun first night. We, in this hour, have had a chance to hear from Heston Kjerstad, who's tearing it up in the Arizona Fall League, as well as Matt Blood, who just joined us, the Orioles Director of Player Development. We heard from Scott Garceau, and then earlier on we heard from Ben McDonald, who is still from all we can tell, driving safely back to Baton Rouge after a hunting trip in Nebraska. And then we also checked in with Roch Kubatko with a free agency and everything getting underway. I did get this this one tweet in terms of, I think that Keith Foreman sent us a tweet. And in terms of, I think maybe we framed it like, when did you know that the Orioles were for real? For Keith, it was when Kyle Bradish dominated the World Series champion Astros, not once but twice. And that was one of the cooler things that we saw. I think that for me, and I'm not sure if Brett Hollander or some other colleagues would agree with this, but I feel like that the moment for me, and we heard it mentioned at times, was the game against the Cardinals, the final game of the series in St. Louis. It was a day game. It was really hot. And they just found a way. They battled and battled and battled. It was a bullpen game. Brian Baker was the opener. And they pieced it together. They got to the very end, and Jorge Mateo makes this over-the-shoulder catch, which was absolutely unbelievable. And it was not the first time that he would do that either. So for me, that was probably the moment when I was like, this team is different. This season could be a little bit different. And it just, like, when you have those types of games and those kinds of moments, you know, you leave the broadcast booth and it just feels a little bit different. It felt that way when, you know, you had John Means' no-hitter, and by, like, the third inning we're thinking, all right, I think he might have no-hit stuff today. And sure enough, he did. He almost threw a perfect game. But I think for me that was probably the turning point. And then you heard Brandon Hyde talk about it after the fact, and how, you know, when he was with the Cubs so many times, his teams would lose games like that. But for me, that was one of the really cool moments. And for me, probably the time when I was like, this team could be really, really good. Some other news and notes and different items. The Orioles nominees for the All-MLB team voting ended up starting today. The Orioles have four different people that you can vote on. Cionel Perez, Felix Bautista, both were electric out of the bullpen this year, and Adley Rutschman and Anthony Santander as well. Both of them were finalists for the Silver Slugger Awards. They didn't end up winning, but you can't ignore the 33 home runs that Santander had or all the success that Adley Rutschman had up at the plate. So good for them, and congratulations to both of them on being nominated. And hopefully everybody will vote, because the All-MLB team is voted on by the fans. So make sure you take part in that as well. One other thing that I wanted to bring up is that Ryan Minor, who, and all of us know Ryan from he was the one who replaced Cal when Cal finally took the day off. Ryan right now is fighting stage 4 colon cancer. I had a chance to talk to him earlier on in the week. He said he's battling, but there's a GoFundMe set up for him. Ryan played for the Orioles. He was a longtime manager and coach in the Orioles minor league system. Trey Mancini had the sign "Stand Up for Cancer," and he wrote Ryan Minor in there. So if you can find a way to support Ryan, he's got two young daughters, his wife Allison. They're wonderful people. Ryan's not only just a great baseball person, but a great dad and great man. So there is a GoFundMe page for him set up by his brother Damon. And if you could help him out, please do so, as he's battling stage 4 colon cancer. We're going to take one more break, and then we're going to get you set up for next week's show. This is the first Orioles Hot Stove show of the offseason on WBAL News Radio 1090 and FM 101.5. So we are back, wrapping things up. Orioles Hot Stove show, the first one, is in the books. And it was a lot of fun. It was great to talk to Ben McDonald about some of the different pitching things that the Orioles have going on right now. He thinks that maybe two starters for the Orioles could certainly help them out. We talked to Roch Kubatko, who's going to be covering everything going on over the next few months for him. Feels like Brandon Hyde has to be right there for American League Manager of the Year, along with Terry Francona. That seems to be his main competition right now. We got to chat with Heston Kjerstad, who has been fabulous in the Arizona Fall League. First time that he's played baseball competitively since 2020, when he was at Arkansas and missed time with myocarditis, but quickly got back into it. I think for him, it's been about as much the mental getting back into it as the physical, too. I mean, trying to catch up with the best pitching that he's ever seen and get his body back in shape and everything like that. But he had a great year on the Orioles farm and is really capping it off really nicely in the Arizona Fall League. Scotty Garceau stopped by, and then we also heard from Orioles Director of Player Development, Matt Blood, who said that he feels like Cody Ashe, who the Orioles just added to their Major League coaching staff as an offensive strategy coach, that he feels like he's going to bring a lot to the table. Somebody that they're sad to lose on the minor league staff, but he was added to the coaching staff, which was recently announced. It's the same group, but Cody is added to that group too. So this is the first of many of these shows. We're going to go into spring training. Brett Hollander is going to be back next week, and we're excited to bring you some more Orioles baseball talk. This has got to be the spot where you are 7-9 on every Thursday night. So for Big Al Hildebeil and Ryan Chell back in the studio, Geoff Arnold saying, enjoy the rest of your night, and we will talk to you next week on WBL News Radio 1090 and FM 101.5.